Let's start with quick introductions of you. You've heard enough about me. And I think the gentleman to my left, because his wife wrote such a good sermon, you know about him. Who's next?
My name is Ben Cunningham. I'm the pastor of Church of the Resurrection in New Orleans.
And?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Tom Ricks, and I'm the director of church planting for the EPC.
And Tim Johnson. And Tim, how far away is the church you've planted?
I believe if we wanted to do MapQuest, we don't do MapQuest anymore, but probably about 10 miles from here inside of what we call the Loop in Memphis, Tennessee.
Okay. All right, so we're going to have some lightning rounds. First, rebuttal or underscoring of what you heard from me. Then we're going to move to you.
Excellent. I wish our whole church was here, but it's really good. I think a good challenge that I'm still thinking about was the terminology of, attachment versus membership. Well done. You have me intrigued. I'm not fully converted, but I'm intrigued.
Okay.
I think the question about have you ever discipled someone who's discipled someone else or seen someone converted that has seen someone else converted, that was very poignant because I think my answer is also no. And I was just thinking through there's sort of content and form to discipleship, and I think we do a lot in the content vein of that, whether it's preaching or teaching or small groups, Bible study, but little to nothing in terms of the form of how do you go about that, just the wisdom, the tact, the process that hit.
Okay.
Mentioning Wayne Gretzky as an illustration.
That one was not in the notes, by the way. That one just came out.
No, but as a hockey fan, that was big. Seriously, when you called out the fact that, you know, gee, we're only one church, what can we do? One church can do a lot, right? So the fact that you said to us, every one of us is important in this mix, every one of us has a part to play, whatever it may be, I think was just dead on the money.
Okay. Quickly, all three of you, where did you come from? Did you come from a church like Hope, or what kind of church, where did God call you out of?
I'm a military brat. My dad ended up pastoring a large African-American church in Mobile, Alabama. I caught the multi-ethnic bug, and God called me through Sandy Wilson, Brian LaRitz, and Rufus Smith to Memphis. I interned and worked in some capacity for a year and a half, 2 years, just all over the Memphis landscape, learning it. And then God just burdened my heart for a particular part of town, and that just so happened to coincide with Second Prez's desire to plant a church.
Awesome.
My dad is a pastor. My grandpas are pastors. Aunts and uncles are pastors. It's the only family business. So we moved around a lot.
I feel like I'm in an episode of My Cousin Vinny.
Yeah. Yeah, we moved around a lot, but a few years ago, about 7 years ago, my wife and I were praying together, and we were thinking, I think the Lord is leading us to plant a church, to do it in a city like New Orleans, and to do it with the EPC, and then the EPC called about planting a church in New Orleans. So that's the general answer of like how we got here, but I think just to be a little bit more specific on that, I like to say that our church started before it started with us. It really began with the proactive just generosity and vision of our supporting churches. So it really wasn't us discerning a call and then coming forward and trying to find somewhere where that could be expressed. It was other churches like yours that God used to deliver that call to us.
Cool. Now these are statistical outliers. Tom, let's see how you're doing.
Well, and they're much more recent. My call to church planting happened in the mid-1990s when I was on the staff at a wonderful church in St. Louis, Central Presbyterian Church. And I was 38 years old, and I was the interim lead pastor, way over my head, of a church of 2,000. And it's a wonderful congregation, but it's what we call a midtown church. So folks come from all over the region. And wonderful friends that I still know that are there, but what struck in my heart was nobody really lives close to each other. They don't have the opportunity for a relationship. And so St. Louis is a very heavy Catholic town, and the parish model of living close to the church you attend. And so when we decided that we wanted to plant a church, we knew we wanted to plant a neighborhood church, a community church where you saw these folks every day of the week. And so, as wonderful as my experience was at a larger congregation, going to be to a community where we targeted the people in that community for the gospel was what really moved me to church planting.
All right, next question's Ben Cunningham, let's start with you. The church you planted, where did you get the first people who formed your core group? And then Pastor Tim Johnson next.
So we kind of thought of it in the beginning, we kind of had concentric circles. We had the immediate sort of leadership team and then, you know, groups kind of going out from there that got larger. People that had ownership in the beginning and then the crowd, you know, we kind of gathered even when we were, before we moved into a sanctuary, before we launched. Our very first members of the leadership team were close friends that we already had in the city, and then friends of friends. Just really no substitute for word of mouth in the early days.
Okay.
Yeah, it was quite interesting because I oftentimes go back and think about I planted where I wasn't from, so I would have loved to have the benefit of being next to my family and friends, but I think the Lord really, he sovereignly set it up in a certain way to work the way that it should. But anyway, Second Perez seated us 10 units. So either marrieds, families, or singles. We strategically talked and encouraged people and cast vision that came along. But I spent probably 8 to 12 months on the ground in my context, working specifically with some nonprofits there. And our first group of probably 20 was probably split between those who Second Press seeded us and those who were coming from the community.
All right, so they were the outliers on the first answer. This one, they are spot on the research that people involved in church plant are either your family and close friends, if you happen to have those in the neighborhood, if not a church that sends some people, and also another source is doing work, networking in the area, and bumping into people on the way. Tom, you've planted churches. Where did you get people from?
Well, the original church plant of Green Tree was all folks that lived in the Kirkwood community, and we were all friends with one another. So I don't know if it was me finding them or them finding me or a combination of the two, but we were at a prayer group at one moment, and we were kind of all sharing the fact that there was not a Reformed evangelical presence in our community, and there really should be. And then we were kind of all silly enough to think that maybe we should do that. But it was relationally solid from the start. It was the people that I knew and loved, respected, and people that knew and loved me.
Awesome. All right, next question is, you seeing God's call on someone else. I don't want you to, like you and your coach from football, maybe he's in the audience, but would you tell us someone that you've spotted that maybe you saw it before they saw it, or maybe they saw it and you've been able to fan the flames, but someone that you're encouraging to take a heightened role in ministry leadership?
Well, every Green Tree Community Church that I planted another six churches in and around the St. Louis region, and every one of those church planters were men with whom I had a friendship of some kind or a mentorship relationship. So they may have been one of our teaching elders here this week, Mike Werkheiser, who came from the Pittsburgh area to go to seminary in St. Louis. He and his wife ended up at Green Tree. Both of them actually ended up on our staff. And about 2 years into that, Mike came to me and said, I think I should plant a church. I think we should take a group and plant a church. Every one of our plants happened like that. There were people with the exception of one, which I do want to talk about for a second. There were people in our midst on some level who knew us and saw what we were doing, saw our commitment to church planting, and wanted to be part of that. The exception to that was when God put it on my heart that we had said as a national leadership team, we want to reach underserved communities, but my church was doing nothing about that, which meant it was on me because I'm the leader. And so I reached out to a friend in St. Louis, a pastor named Michael Jones, who's a new pastor of a church in St. Louis. And I said, are there any young men in your congregation that perhaps have the gift of church planting, and you maybe don't have a spot where you're going to be using them, because I don't know anything about planting a church in an underserved community. And he introduced me to Sean Boone. Boone's here this week, I think. I gave him a hug a day ago. I think he's still here. And that was our church plant in Ferguson. And that's a story in and of itself, which we do not have time to tell. But that was an amazing, that was like my most amazing church planting experience, because I didn't know anything. And I had to lean on the church planter to teach me, which was really a reverse. But it was one of the most amazing experiences that I've had in church planting. And I think maybe the one I'm most proud of, because of just how God did that with two guys from very different backgrounds, very different ages. Boone's a lot younger than me. And yet God said, this is a work I'm going to do. And if you will just tag along, I'll make this happen. And that was just a remarkable experience.
Awesome. Tim Johnson, somebody.
I think, you know, I guess Strength Finder says woo is a part of their deal, but that's not in the Bible. I guess it's not a spiritual gift, woo. But I would just say, man, you know, church planters are different people. I think we just have to be honest about that conversation. And so I think being able to discern, am I looking for a pastor or a church planter? Those are two different conversations. These are two different conversations. And so all that being said, I think those of us know when you're looking at a church planter, some people are great pastors and will be great organizational leaders and shepherds and so on and so forth. But we know when we're looking at a church planter. And I think what you do is you grab them. It's almost the way you talk about evangelism, and seeing the person, and loving them and building the trust, supporting them, their wives, their families, and then just kind of just creating an environment of trust, so that in time, you're gonna get behind their vision. You're just empowering them, not strong-arming them.
Ben Cunningham, and then I have one last question for everybody.
Yeah, just to build on what Tim said, I think one of the things I've learned through trial and error, I wish I could speak to this even more clearly when I started, was I think we're looking, if we're talking about church planting particularly, we're looking for folks for whom church planting is not just a means to an end, and that where it's not just a pathway to a set position to be a lead pastor of an established church. Because I think if that is the reason someone's going to church planting, it's going to be very tough sledding, because there's so much entrepreneurial vision, self-starting, things like that's required. Tim is just speaking to that. So discerning that, just trying to listen for a very particular vision and help trying to smoke some of that out of just what exactly is God calling you to.
Mm. All right, great. Last question. I want you to imagine there's someone out here who is discouraged and says, man, my whole focus is just getting through Sunday, survival. How in the world could we begin to think about replication, multiplication, giving energy to a church plant? Do you have a word of advice or encouragement to say there's a pathway beyond where you're at right now?
I think it just goes back to really the fulcrum of our relationship in the kingdom. We came by faith, and we're going to thrive by faith. There ain't never going to be a perfect time to plant a church. And if you keep doing it based on that metric and that rubric, you'll never plant a church. I was recently somewhere and I heard a presentation and they said, how could you essentially afford not to? And I think it has to become that kind of question. It's like, how could you be a gospel-centered, spirit-driven church that can afford not to multiply? Answer me that.
Hmm. Ben Cunningham?
Yeah, just to speak to our experience, I have no doubt that 5 out of 5 of our parent churches were also exhausted and felt depleted and were stressed out of their minds. But I can just tell you, the thought, having the backing that we did, the support and the love from churches exactly like yours, was galvanizing for us on a weekly, if not daily, basis. It added so much just credibility and joy and security. Everyone knew this is not just Ben's musings in a coffee shop, but this is a real movement, the Spirit of God. You mean God's Spirit has already spoken to five other congregations about this, and they're behind us? That's a thrilling thing to be a part of together. Mm.
Tom Ricks, land the plane, and then I'm going to offer a blessing for everyone, and then we're done.
I think the danger, if you haven't planted before, is looking at the mountain and saying, how do you eat an elephant? You eat it one bite at a time. And so how do you kind of bring it down to what's the first step we could take? And the first step is always prayer. There's no question about that. But a good second step in the EPC would be to get online and get you mentioned our 101 manual. And it was written specifically for people that were asking the question, how on earth could we begin this? And there's a very practical how-to. Now, we kind of have put the entire elephant in there to tell you how to do it kind of from start to finish, but just take the first bite and see what God does with that. Begin with, the first thing we say is pray for 6 months, before you do anything. Take that step, and God will show you what the next step is. Mm.
Thank you. I'd like to bless you. This is not a prayer. It's benediction. Benediction is a good word. May God, who loves each person in here differently and who has a different calling for each of you, but all the same vision, that we would help populate heaven. May he help you flourish in your current ministry, and may he give you the faith to know the next step you could take and need to take to be part of populating heaven greater through church planting. Through Jesus our Lord, amen. Thank you.